Welcome to Stuff They Didn't Teach Me in Sunday School. I think I was about 12 or 13 years old at the time. I spent some time every summer down at my grandfather's farm until I worked full-time in the summertime. And one particular evening, we'd finished with the chores, the milking, the feeding the cattle. My cousin and I took the tractor out and went to shoot some frogs in the pond. Came back in at dusk, or maybe it was even dark. I was driving the tractor and hot-rodding it a little bit. There was dew on the grass, and I stepped on the brake right before I got to a gate. It skidded, and the tractor went right through the gate. There were cattle in that field, in that pasture, and some horses in that pasture, too. I couldn't go away and leave that gate open. So I left my cousin there, left the tractor sitting there, and went to find Grandpa. Remember, I told Grandpa, I didn't want to tell him this, but I told him, I just drove the tractor through your gate out in the south pasture. And I said, I don't know what to do about it. He said, well, there's three things you can do about it, Bruce. You can take some boards out there right now and fix it so the cattle can't get out. And then tomorrow's Sunday, you and Dave usually go fishing or swimming or whatever. You can go out there and build me a gate. And you cannot drive that tractor like that anymore. I made atonement for driving that tractor through the fence, and that was the last time I drove that tractor that way. And Grandpa made a point. We're looking at the prophets right now, and one of the prophets we're looking at, the prophet we're looking at in today's session, is the prophet Micah. And he addresses that issue for Israel. What can you do, Israel, to atone, to make up, to repent for the way you've been treating your God? The prophet Micah lives at about the same time as Isaiah. We don't know a whole lot about him. We do know that his book starts off in a rather unique way. In chapter 1, verse 2, it starts out, "Hear ye, hear ye." Actually, "Hear you peoples, all of you." And if that "hear ye" sounds familiar and you equate it with a court scene, that's what you ought to do. The book of Micah starts out with a lawsuit. A lawsuit where God is bringing charges against his people. In Hebrew, it's called a reev, R-I-V, a reev, a covenant lawsuit. God basing a lawsuit upon the covenant in the Old Testament and bringing charges against his people. Now, the key with a covenant lawsuit, and it's true with this first section of Micah too, is that God is the judge. Oh, and God is the prosecuting attorney. And God is the witnesses. Oh, yes, and God is the jury. Judah is the defendant. Do you want to guess who's going to win that trial and who's going to lose that trial? If you guess God is going to win, you're right. He brings charges in the next few verses against his people. He brings charges against them because they've been unfaithful to him, because they've forsaken him and gone after the Baals. And the rest of the book then outlines what the results of that desertion that these people have carried out, this unfaithfulness that they've existed in, how that will be punished, how that will be brought down upon the people. Micah is the first prophet to actually mention the name of the invading nation, and he mentions Babylon. There are a couple other interesting sections in the book of Micah. Actually, the whole book is very interesting. But one of them, if you go to chapter 6, about verse 6, the people come to God, and they're saying, what are we going to do about this? Okay, you've made the charge, and I think this probably is God wishing they would come to him and ask this question, because they never do. But in Micah's account of this conversation between God and his people, the people say, what do we do? And it reads this way, "With what shall I come before Yahweh and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old?" This is in Micah 6:6. In other words, shall I bring the offering of the wealthy? Shall I bring my best livestock and burn it up for God? "Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? And here's the answer, and I think this is a key verse for the book of Micah. He has shown you, O man, what is good. And what does Yahweh require of you? But to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. No, he doesn't want your dead bulls. He doesn't want your dead calves. He doesn't even want your firstborn. What he wants is your heart. And when he has your heart, he will also see that play out in the way you live your life, in doing justice and loving kindness in your walk with God. Micah is significant also for a promise that's there, as God in all the prophets says, there'll come a day after I haul you off into captivity when I bring you back. There'll come a day when I call you mine. There'll come a day when I restore my people, and there'll come that ultimate day when I restore all my people to a relationship with me. Very famous passage in Micah chapter 5, verse 2. You hear it in Sunday school stories. Usually you get the second grader with no front teeth who ends up with this particular passage. But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, who are little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose origin is from of old, from ancient days. And if you skip down to verse 4, and he shall stand and feed his flock in the strength of Yahweh. God promises that one would come forth one of these days, that he would come out of the town of Bethlehem, and that this messenger, this emissary from God himself, would have an impact on the nation and draw all the people to himself. These pictures of the Messiah that you see in the prophets are like a flower blooming. You don't see the whole flower all at once. You see a little bit of it at a time. And here you see a little bit of information about that Messiah, that he would come from Bethlehem and that he would draw people to himself. Micah, like most of the prophets, all of the prophets in the Old Testament, gives you a word of law, a word of judgment, that God would judge his people by hauling them off into captivity, and a word of hope that he would bring them back from Babylon, but he would ultimately bring them back from their captivity to sin, death, and the devil, and make them his own through a Savior.